Right now, on this Memorial Day 2021, we bring in Arthur Schwartz, the food maven. Good morning, Arthur.
Good morning. Is our connection okay?
It sounds fine to me right now.
Okay, good. Let's hope it holds.
I know.
To tell everybody, I'm on a cell phone instead of a landline today. So, it's Memorial Day. And for various reasons, I have clam chowder on my mind. A friend the other day said, oh, that's a perfect Memorial Day dish. I don't know about that. But I have a thing. If I eat something bad in a restaurant, as I did in Cape May, I had the worst clam chowder ever made. And I'm exaggerating because it's probably worse, but it was pretty bad. Since then, weeks, I've been craving a good New England clam chowder, which is actually not so easy to find outside of your own house. On the other hand, I'm also aching to do a little travel, and as it is, my niece is in Georgia this weekend, attending a family wedding, and she took her all day, literally all day on Saturday, from a flight that left at 11 o'clock until she finally got to where she was going in Georgia at 8 o'clock at night. So it was 9 hours to get nowhere. As she said, to get to the middle of nowhere. Anyway, so I'm thinking I want to take a trip with the car along the Connecticut coast into Rhode Island, and I will sample good chowder along the way. You know, there are three kinds that I know of clam chowder. There's Manhattan clam chowder, which is a tomato chowder with vegetables in it. And some people disdain it and say, oh, it's just vegetable soup with clams. Okay, that's okay. I'll take vegetable soup with clams. My grandfather, Barney Schwartz, had his own food business for many years. And he sold foods to bars and grills. And one of the items was Manhattan clam chowder. And so I used to go to his house, and he'd be busy with this huge pot making clam chowder because he actually didn't know how to make it just for the family. He only knew how to make it in large batches. You know, I have to say that if you're going to make clam chowder and you have to do all this dicing and rendering of pork fat and stuff like that, you might as well make a big pot and you can refrigerate it for a few days or freeze it. But anyway, so that's one kind of chowder, vegetables and tomato and clams. Another kind of chowder is the one that most people are familiar with these days, is New England clam chowder, sometimes called Down East clam chowder, which is cream-based clam chowder. I love it myself. And then there's a third kind, which is not really well-known, except to people from Connecticut and Rhode Island, which is usually called Rhode Island clam chowder, but I don't know why it's not called Connecticut clam chowder, because it's made in Connecticut as well. In fact, my first experience with it was when I went to summer camp. Now, I went to camp until I was 16, and the last year or two, I was either an assistant counselor or a counselor, and the counselors got a day off, and the camp was in Colchester, in Connecticut. Have you been to Colchester lately or anywhere near there?
Not lately. Not since we started the radio station, I don't go anywhere.
I understand that. Well, you know, in those days, it was on Lake Gardner, which is a very large lake. In fact, I think it's the second largest lake in Connecticut. I don't know what the first largest is. And around Lake Gardner were several summer camps. Now I hear it's all condos, communities around the lake. Could well be. Anyway, on our day off as a counselor or an assistant counselor, we got to go off campus. And one of the places we would go would be New London, which was the closest big town to us. And in New London, we used to go, I didn't discover this myself, some older counselor knew about this. We used to go to this diner in New London for lunch, and they had amazing Connecticut-style clam chowder, which had neither cream nor tomatoes. It was sort of a mucky gray broth, but delicious. My theory on Manhattan clam chowder is that Southern Italians who settled in southern Connecticut and southern, and, you know, along the coast in Rhode Island, said, oh, this is such an ugly dish. Why don't they put tomatoes in it? So I think Manhattan clam chowder evolved from Connecticut / Rhode Island clam chowder. It's a good chowder. I like the simple clam broth with potatoes and rendered pork fat and some onions. And that's about it. And you could add cream to that. It would be New England chowder. If you had tomatoes and maybe some celery, it would be Manhattan clam chowder. So I think I'm going to take a ride. We're going to go on a little excursion. And we're going to end up at... oh, by the way, the reason... there were all these Italians down there, is they came in the 19th century to work the granite quarries. And, you know, isn't Rhode Island the granite state? And on one side of the Pawtucket River settled a lot of Calabrians, and on the other side of the Pawtucket River settled a lot of Sicilians. And so the locals, to this day, called the Pawtucket, the Straits of Messina, which is the body of water that separates Sicily and Calabria back in Italy. They're all friendly these days, but I have to say that in general, Calabrians and Sicilians are competitive with each other. But in this case, at least now, 100-something years later, they all get along very well, and I think the two communities are quite integrated. And I can understand why they would want to put tomatoes in the broth. But I also like to make Italian-style clams, which is the easiest thing to do, a sauté of clams, or mussels, for that matter. By the way, I had some really bad mussels recently, too, so now I'm craving mussels, because I got to make them better than I have them. This is also in Cape May, and the mussels were cooked in a broth made with seriously bad wine. So I couldn't eat the broth, and to me, it's almost as much about the broth as it is about the mussels themselves. And truthfully, the mussels weren't all that good either. People are getting up, so you might hear a little screaming in the background.
That's okay.
It's okay. There are two little girls here. I've been babysitting all weekend. Their mother is away, I told you, at a wedding. And the papa, my nephew, is on call at the hospital and did a liver transplant yesterday, last night, I should say. And it's a 10-hour surgery, so he came home in the middle of the night. And I hear that his girls are saying he's up. Well, maybe. So I like just cooking them. You just saute some garlic in good olive oil until the garlic... doesn't color, but, you know, you might see a tiny change in color around the edge. It's not over high heat. And a little hot pepper flakes. And you throw your mussels or clams into the pan, cover the pan, shake it a little bit. And usually it doesn't take more than 4 or 5 minutes for the mussels or the clams to open up, and they'll give off quite a bit of broth. And that's called, in Naples, a sauté of clams or a sauté of mussels. And if it sounds like spaghetti with clam sauce, you'd be right. It's just if you make spaghetti with clam sauce, you maybe change the proportions a little bit. And you might use in Naples, of course, they have these tiny clams. I use sometimes manila clams, which aren't really clams. They're cockles. But manila clams work very well. I wouldn't want a saute of manila clams necessarily because they're so tiny. But if you're making a pasta to go under it, spaghetti with clam sauce, then you could use the manila clams. And that's about it. But a Down East or New England clam chowder is quite different. And I learned my recipe, which, by the way, you can find in Soup Suppers, my best-selling cookbook. It's called Down East Clam Chowder, and as the intro to the recipe says, I learned this from a woman who grew up in Falmouth, Massachusetts on Cape Cod. In fact, she was my first boss, Barbara Rader, who was the food editor of Newsday back in the 60s. God, am I old. And I figured if she didn't know how to make great clam chowder, nobody did. The food editor of Newsday, who grew up in Falmouth. And she learned to make clam chowder from her mother, who was a native of Cape Cod, too. So I think this is a pretty authentic recipe. The only thing in this recipe that's really different than other recipes you will find is that Barbara told me you use those big, tough, quahog-type clams, the big clams, and because you wouldn't use a tiny clam or a small, even a regular small clam in a chowder. You just eat those on the half shell or maybe with a little condiment on top. But the big ones, which are tough, are the ones that you use in chowder. Sometimes they're even sold as chowder clams. And you steam them open in a large pot. You just put the clams in a little bit of water, and you place it over high heat, cover it, let it steam. The clams will open in no more than 5 minutes. And then you use tongs or a slotted spoon to take the clams out and shell them. Now, you can throw the shells away, of course, unless you have little girls, as I do here, who love clam shells. Love painting them, love playing with them. And you strain the clam broth and measure it out. And if you need to, you can add a little water to make 2 cups of broth. Now, here's the part that's so different than every other recipe. You grind the clams in a meat grinder. You can use a food processor, but truthfully, I prefer an old-fashioned meat grinder. Now, I have an electric one that goes onto my KitchenAid mixer, but I also have my grandma's old grinder, which I use all the time, even though it had originally been kosher. Now, it was doing clams. Very open-minded meat grinder. And you grind the clams. So now you have ground clams, and you have clam broth. And now you start making out the chowder. And the first thing you have to do is, if you're making a classic chowder, you want to use salt pork. Cut into quarter-inch cubes. It's about a half a cup of salt pork. It's not an enormous amount. And you put that in the big pot and fry it out, meaning let it the fat render. And even you can even get the pork a little crispy brown. And then you add onions, quite a few onions. I would say 2 medium onions. Finely chopped. That's 2 cups of onion. You add that to the salt pork fat, and you saute the onions for a few minutes until they're limp. And then you add your potatoes. Now, I'm on a no-carb diet, but I'm going to allow myself potatoes to make a good chowder because there's nothing else in the chowder that's high-carb. And since I've lost a lot of weight, I'm going to treat myself to a couple of potatoes this week. And take about 3 medium. You need 3 cups of half-inch cubes of potato, and you put that in with the onions and stir it around a little bit in the flavored oil. Fat, actually, it's pork fat, and then you add 2 cups of water, the 2 cups of clam broth. So now you have a quart of liquid, and some pepper, just freshly ground black pepper. Bring it to a simmer over medium heat. And then cook it gently, partially covered. You don't want much evaporation. So cook it gently until the potatoes are tender. This is probably going to take more than 10 or 15 minutes. Then stir in the secret ingredient. Now, I questioned this ingredient when I first got the recipe from Barbara Rader, but it's evaporated milk. I said, evaporated milk? She said, oh, yeah, it's totally traditional on Cape Cod to use evaporated milk. So it's a 13-ounce can of evaporated milk and 2 cups of heavy cream. Remember, you have a quart of thin liquid here, so adding all this milk and cream isn't going to really make it more, it's going to make it creamy, but it's not going to make it thick. So then you put in, so you heat that through, the cream and the milk, and as soon as it comes to a simmer, you can add your chopped clams and heat it through. But don't let it simmer again. Just heat it through. And if it comes to a boil, shut the heat off right away. Let it cool. And another secret, let it rest for at least 4 hours. But truthfully, I like to refrigerate it overnight and heat up the chowder the next day. because the potatoes themselves provide the thickening. And if you let the potatoes sit in the hot liquid and cooling down in the liquid, the starch in the potatoes themselves will add just enough thickening. I cannot tolerate New England clam chowder when it's flour thickened. And the one that I had in Cape May, which I said was probably the worst ever, was not only had too many potatoes, but it was like wallpaper paste because it had so much flour in it. So once you've let this rest, you have your whole complete soup. All you need to do is reheat it, never allowing the chowder to boil. I say this only because the clams tend to toughen when they're boiled, but if they're just heated, they won't. And also, by the way, I think that this resting either at least 4 hours or overnight, I think it also does help tenderize the clams in some way. I need a scientist to tell me how that's happened. And that's it.
You know,
it's
what,
a great chowder.
You know what's interesting about that recipe? Years ago, Arthur, I entered a clam, I forget who sponsored it, a clam chowder contest, okay?
Uh-huh.
I used that recipe. And it's funny when you got to the grounding of the clams down. I did it with a food processor because I didn't have another one. But I did everything you said. And at the end, though, I think because I liked it, I probably lost. It's the reason I didn't win or even come in top three. I added some more butter in at the end. Just to make
I'm
it look.
I'm sorry. I don't know why that would have made you lose. I think that would have made you win.
it added a sheen to it, and nice, just a nice smoothness to it. No, there were other, there were a lot of restaurant cooks there, but that was the recipe that I found that I followed.
Yeah. Well, I must say that I'm very proud that even if you lost, that you used my recipe. Got to say that recipe is in Soup Suppers, which is my best selling cookbook. It's still in print after all these years. In fact, I don't even know how many years is it. Let me see what the copyright is on this. And believe it or not, I still get royalties. This is the only book I get royalties on. But, you know, I got $69 last year. Not a lot. So when people think you get rich writing cookbooks, boy, are they wrong. This book came out in 1994. So how many years ago is that? 27 years ago.
Yeah.
And what's interesting, I was thumbing through it this morning, and there's some recipe that I was reading that said, oh, you know, you would think this would have evolved over the many years that I've been making it, but it hasn't. And I have to look. A lot of these recipes I make just the same. There's a few of them change. But, you know, in 27 years, your cooking changes, too. So I do want to make a Manhattan clam chowder because it's very nostalgic for me. That was my grandfather's chowder. And Barney was a very good cook, I have to say. In fact, this is, I think, funny. My nephew, Brian, whose house I'm in right now, he loves to make the cocktails. And he has a whole repertoire these days. And the other day he said, how about I make you blah, blah? And I said, fine. And he used a product that he bought in a store called Rock and Rye. He said, oh, did you ever hear of Rock and Rye? I said, did I ever hear of Rock and Rye? Barney Schwartz, my grandfather, did not drink. But he made rock and rye. And the only time you were allowed to drink the rock and rye was when you had a cold, when you got sick. You know, my other grandfather had the same cold remedy himself. If you got a cold, he gave you a shot of scotch, even when I was a little boy, a shot of scotch, a cup of honey lemon tea, and then you had to go to bed and let it sweat out. My grandfather, Barney, was the same way, except that he used rock and rye. And I made rock and rye when I was younger. I haven't made it in many years. In fact, I even gave my grandfather's recipe for rock and rye to another cookbook author who used it in her cookbook as a Christmas gift. I said, this is something to give as a gift, and it's nothing to do. You not quite fill a jar with rye whiskey, very popular these days. For a period in my life, you couldn't find rye whiskey. Now it's everywhere. By the way, I like Rittenhouse rye, which is 100 proof and is a very good price, usually in the low $20, depends on the tax in your state. And anyway, you more or less fill a jar with rye, rock sugar, you know, candy rock sugar. And for my grandfather's recipe, you took an orange and wedged it and put the wedges of whole orange, peel and the pulp in the jar, and you just let it sit for, I don't know how long, but I would think at least a couple of weeks. Maybe longer is better, probably. I don't know. My grandfather's was, as I said, in a jar at a high shelf in the kitchen so that nobody could reach it but him, although he wasn't that tall. And I think it was mainly to keep it out of eyesight also. And you hit it up every once in a while. So it stayed there for years. And I think that gets better over time. And, of course, the rock candy, the sugar, will dissolve in the rock. I'm not sure why you can't use regular old sugar in this, except, you know, it takes a while to dissolve, but so does the rock candy. Anyway, Barney made this great clam chowder. And there is a recipe in Soup Suppers for a Manhattan fish chowder. It's based on my grandfather's clam chowder. And that's, you saute a lot of onions, 5 cups of onions, in 1/4 cup of oil. Now, in the book, I say 1/4 cup of delicately flavored olive oil. I guarantee you Barney did not use any kind of olive oil, although he did, actually, because he made a lot of Italian food. But he would have rendered out some pork fat, some salt pork, sauteed the onions, and then added, with leaves, 2 large celery ribs. Now, I find it very, it's not always that you can get celery these days with the leaves still attached, but if you can, do it. About 1.5 cups of celery. A large green pepper, chopped. That's about 1 cup. 3 large cloves of garlic, finely chopped. And you saute all of that together with the garlic, too. And then you add, once they're soft, in about 10 minutes, you add 2 large potatoes. I usually use russets, but it doesn't have any Yukon Gold kind of potato. Any kind of boiling or all-purpose potato is fine. Cut into 1/4-inch cubes. It's about 3 cups. And you stir the potatoes into the vegetables until it's all coated and with oil or with pork fat, whichever you're using. And then you add your tomatoes. Now, this is interesting, I think. Mostly, in these days, you only find 28-ounce cans of plum tomatoes. But there are some recipes in this book, because so many years ago, it's calling for 35-ounce cans. Truthfully, it doesn't matter all that much when you're making soup. So once you've got the potatoes in there, then add your tomatoes, plum tomatoes. They can either be coarsely chopped, or what I do these days is, just because it's fun for me, I squeeze them in my hands and I crush them in the bowl. On the other hand, you could take the bowl of tomatoes and use your potato masher and mash them up. And you put in the tomatoes, and then you need either fish stock or what I would use is bottled clam juice, which is very easy to find in the supermarket these days. So I would use 3 cups of water and 3 cups of bottled clam juice, which is pretty strong, and then about 3/4 teaspoon of dried thyme. Now, thyme is essential flavor to Manhattan clam chowder, and I don't know how the thyme got in there. 1 large bay leaf, and, of course, you want to season this with pepper. And that's it. Let it all simmer together, and then you add your chopped clams, or you can use this base, this sort of chowder base, to cook any fish. Doesn't have to be clams. Could be, in fact, my favorite stew fish, my favorite soup fish, is monkfish, which is very inexpensive as far as fish go, which are expensive. And I would cut it into no more than 1-inch slices. You know, the monkfish, you're just eating the tail of the fish. There's no bones. There is a filament that a lot of people tell you to remove before you cook it. But I find if you're cooking the fish for 15 minutes or longer, and monkfish takes a while, it can be tough if it's not cooked thoroughly. It used to be used as fake crab meat or lobster because of the texture. I don't see it at all, but anyway. So you simmer the fish, and if you don't remove that skin, that filament, it'll get soft and dissolve, and it won't be a problem. It's only if you're doing, and I've never been successful with this, like roasting monkfish. if you really want to remove that. And that's it, 15 minutes, and you've got a really, really good chowder, as they say in the Down East, it's chowder. And, you know, I'm looking forward to Stonington and what are those other towns way east Connecticut?
Well, you got New London, and you go up to Stonington, and you've got, I think he's in Essex down there as well.
Is it Noank? I think the place that I remember so fondly is Abbott's. I think it's Noank. Is that the name of the town?
I have no idea.
There by Stonington. It's right on the coast there. And the thing that if you mention this Abbott's to Bob, the first thing he'll tell you is that a seagull stole his lobster roll. Because the seagulls, of course, know this place very well. And if you eat outside, I'm thinking we could probably eat inside now. But if you eat outside at Abbott's, the seagulls will swoop down, and if you're not careful, they'll steal your lunch.
Abbott's is still in business.
Yeah. Yep. I don't know. They must be. They're probably in business for 80 years or more. Yeah. I don't know. It's been around as long as I remember, and I do remember they had very, very good lobster rolls.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they have good chowder. Well, I'm not sure anymore, but they used to have good chowder. And I'm sure I'm going to find good chowder down there, and also some really good fresh clams. And mussels, I can buy very good mussels, I have to say. And thinking about mussels, the first thing I always think of is what a chore it is to clean them. And when I was young and I made mussels, I do love mussels, and the things you can do with them. I used to invite this particular friend who also adored mussels, and I said, if you want me to cook the mussels for you, you're going to have to help me clean them. And we would sit there by the sink, I don't know, for at least an hour or so, taking the beards off the mussels, rubbing them together to get the barnacles off. In those days, mussels were mainly harvested in the wild, and they were really filthy. Nowadays, they're all farmed, and they're clean, and although you will see beards on them, you won't see a lot of barnacles or other kind of schmutz that needs to be cleaned. When I think of that, I always think of, in Naples, the fishermen, if you go down to the fishing port, or the fish market, you'll see the fishermen rubbing the mussels together to clean them. And they get so polished by this process that they really do look jewel-like once they're cleaned in a broth or in a sauté. Very nice. I'm not doing that anymore. I'm buying relatively clean mussels.
Well, let me know next week how your lobster
my chowder
and your chowder drive-through goes.
Well, I don't know when I'm going to Rhode Island, but you know I do love Newport. I have to say, and I did eat very well in Newport last time I was there. So it's hard to find good food in a restaurant these days. I'm finding, and even in New York, my friends are complaining that the restaurants are so low in staff, probably in the kitchen as well as in the dining room, that you're not getting the food or the service you were pre-COVID.
Yeah.
And I think that'll all change in the next couple of months. A lot of people are offering incentives for people to come back to work. And I do know a couple of chefs who've left the city because they couldn't find work in New York. But they'll eventually come back, too.
All right.
It's a gloomy day here in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia. Is the sun shining in Sharon?
No, but it's expected finally to come out this afternoon.
That's what we hear here, too. I don't know. So we're going to hit the road today. The babysitting gig is over. I think I'm getting too old to mind a 7 and a 5-year-old. They have more energy than you can even imagine.
Much more. All right, Arthur, have a safe trip back.
Well, you too. I keep having a bird question for you, but it'll have to wait till off air.
Okay.
All right, have a great week, everybody.
You too, Arthur.
A mindful Memorial Day.
That's it. Take care, Arthur.
Bye.
Arthur Schwartz, the Food Maven here on Robin Hood Radio. Underwriting support for Arthur Schwartz, the Food Maven, John Andrews Restaurant on the Hillsdale Road in South Egremont, 413-528-3467, and on the web, jarestaurant.com. Rubiner's Cheesemongers and Grocers on Main Street in Great Barrington, 413-528-0488, rubiners.com. Hillsdale Home Chef, more information, 518-325-7000, hgshomechef.com.